So much information was given to us this week, and it sends the investigation into a whole new direction. This has been my favorite episode of the season so far, and there's a lot to go over, so let's decode Only Murders in the Building. Before we get into it, I must tell you that I am an admin in the Only Murders in the Building Facebook group, and I regularly watch comments and approve posts to make sure that they're not negative, but I have come across quite a bit of spoilers that I have to reject. I was upset that I kept seeing this stuff. I still am, but I feel like continuing to be an admin there, at least for the rest of the season, I'm able to stop it from being spoiled for like 19,000 other people. I was an admin in a second group, but that one decided to allow leaked photos and storylines to be published from future episodes, ruining the ending, even though it is 100% illegal. Because of the pictures I've seen and posts and comments that I've read in order to deny, I won't make any statements on who or who I think is the killer, nor will I comment on anything that I've seen and posts. I will give my thoughts on the episode and things I did not see. Even though I have seen some spoilers, there will be no spoilers here. With that said, let's get into it. This week we open up with a voiceover from Detective Krebs. One interesting note is that he mentioned alimony payments. I think this could be a hint that he is Lucy's father, or at the very least, a former partner of Lucy's mother. I love the scene of Mabel and Krebs in the gym. Mabel stood her ground against a very big man, very tall man, who constantly talked down to her. It's nice to see her finally really standing her ground. Krebs has a big ego, and he knew that both of them knew he was Glitter Guy, but he believed he still had power, and his ego was his downfall. He starts by saying that Mabel is an amateur podcaster, and she sucks and things like that, but the nail in the coffin was that he stated he was able to make a better podcast, letting Mabel know that he had been a part of All Is Not Okay in Oklahoma. And with that, it's possible that he has helped them with other cases that she has supposedly solved. Senda mentioning his reputation was not stellar is a nice throw-off to make it seem as if they didn't know each other before that moment. We then get the reveal of the DNA test. I don't understand why it was delayed so long. Maybe to have more of a punch in a single episode because we had quite a bit of things revealed. I think Oliver is being very negligent by not telling Will the truth, even though in the short term, it seems to make him feel better about it. The truth will come out one way or another, and that's going to be hard on Will. Not only finding out that he had a different dad and a half-brother, but that his father was untruthful to him. I feel like this sets up Teddy to die at the end of the season. Howard saw them fighting in the elevator, and Oliver even threatened to kill Teddy. It would be a very emotional season if this were to happen, Will never getting to know his real dad, and Theo losing him after he attempts to fix all his wrongs. At the end of the day, Oliver does have good intentions, and he now states that his son Will is all he has, opposed to his apartment and theater being what meant the most to him in season 1. I hope he's able to fix the situation before it gets any worse. The reveal of the painting was interesting. I've heard the theory about the painting being in the birdcage very early on, but I didn't think it was possible whatsoever, so kudos to everyone who thought that. I felt that the show for the painting was too quick and easy, and it was a little bit gimmicky, but it does make sense that Bunny would have a copy made for display in her apartment. The reveal that Ruse Cooper is in fact just Ruse Cooper and not Lenora Folger at all was very interesting move. I did not see that coming at all. I don't know if anyone thought that. No one that I ever talked to thought that. I don't believe, but if you did mention that, let me know down below because I forgot or I may have looked over it. I like the idea that she was playing everyone just to get the painting back, but I would have thought that some people there, someone, at least the older ones like Lester, would know what Lenora looks like even if it had been 30 years. The painting underneath the painting was a very warm moment. It was nice to know that his father was arrested for trying to protect Rose, and for all the thoughts Charles had about his father, he can rest knowing that he really cared about his son, and he just wanted the best for him, He wanted to be the best father that he could be. Alice came back and tried to make amends with Mabel, and it does seem that her heart was in the right place, but she just went about it the wrong way. I think it would be nice to see her come back next season in a limited capacity. The big reveal of this episode is the fact that Poppy is Becky Butler, a name we first heard in season 1, episode 1, podcast that Cinda Canning's empire was started on. The dynamic between Poppy and Cinda and Krebs is interesting, and I don't know how it all works. I don't know if Poppy is telling the truth. Cinda made a comment about Poppy not correcting her pronunciation of Chickasha. Was that something Poppy did to throw off the fact that she is, in fact, Becky? I wonder if Cinda knows. All Is Not Okay in Oklahoma was made in 2020, but Becky went missing in 2015. There's a 5-year window that's unaccounted for. Episode 2 of All Is Not Okay is called Becky's Reputation, and it goes over her reputation and past relationships. Maybe she could have been seen as promiscuous or something, especially, I'm not familiar with Chickasha or Chickasha. There could be a parallel with her needing to get away from an abusive person, just as Rose Cooper did. Maybe she wanted to start over, and Cinda helped her. It's clear that Krebs used DNA to make it look as if Becky was somewhere she wasn't. But was Becky complicit, or did she find out after the fact and then become an intern for Cinda? If Krebs is helping Cinda with all these cases, did he help some innocent person go to prison for Becky's death? Also, I'm assuming, though it wasn't confirmed, that Becky's body was supposedly found. Without it, everything is very circumstantial and it's hard to get confirmed that anyone is actually dead. They may be presumed dead, but you can't say that without any body usually. Whose body is it? Or was it just her hair and panties? Quite a few of you, and especially Morticia, had stated that she thought that it was going to be Poppy or Cinda or both of them before the season even started. I said no, I didn't think so, because I assumed that her podcasting empire was legit. So at the top of it, Morticia, I don't know if you can hear these little claps, but those are for you. You definitely got it on the head. I never would have saw this coming. Another question: why was Cinda or Poppy snooping around about the painting, talking to Rose Cooper? Did they figure out Rose's identity? Did they somehow know of her relationship with Charles's father and attempt to use it as a motive? I don't think some of these questions will be answered, but I want to pose them in case they end up being loose ends at the end of this season. I also have no idea what 14 and Savage means. If anyone has any idea, please let me know down below. And I wondered if Bunny knew Charles's father's balls were on her wall. Only one more episode left, and one more Only Murders in the Building video until the giveaway. Episode 10 is the last chance to enter in and win $50 in Only Murders in the Building merchandise. All you gotta do is be a subscriber, leave a comment on any video about Only Murders in the Building, and you'll automatically be entered in. Do you think that Cinda is the killer, or is it someone else? What has been your favorite episode so far? Let me know all your thoughts down below. My name is Dallas. I thank you for watching, and I'll catch you on the rooftop.